गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन, एम आई ऑडिबल?
यस सर।
थैंक यू। ओके, सो वील कंटिन्यू विद द बोल्ट्जमैन ट्रांसपोर्ट फॉर्मलिज्म एंड स्टार्ट विद अ रिकैपिटुलेशन। सो बेसिकली द बोल्ट्जमैन ट्रांसपोर्ट फॉर्मलिज्म इज अ सेमी क्लासिकल इक्वेशन एंड दिस सेमी क्लासिकल इक्वेशन इज फॉर्मुलेटेड as the total time derivative of the distribution function is basically given by the collision integral. So it's represented in different ways. And this is where, for example, the semi-classical nature goes in. That is, we use the Newton's laws and the Fermi-Dirac distribution. So that's where the semi-classical nature has already gone in. And here you can introduce the quantum mechanical scattering processes. So combining these two, basically you get the Boltzmann transport equation. And the total time, and since the distribution function is a function of r, k, and time, okay, the total derivative is basically given by the explicit derivative and then the implicit derivatives. So for the implicit derivatives, you will have a del k by del t dot gradient with respect to k of f plus del r by del t dot gradient with respect to r of f. All right. So this is where the external force comes in, and this is where the velocity comes in. Okay, so this is the explicit time derivative. So if there is an explicit time dependence, then that can come in here. And the collision integral or the collision term, the scattering term, there are several models for it, so you can write down several models for it. And one of the models is the relaxation time approximation. Okay, this is one of the models. Then in general, okay, in general, this collision integral is given by this expression. This is equal to V by 2 pi whole cube. And all the different scattering processes into the k and out of the k, okay, k state. So it can be given by 1 minus f of k w k k dash f of k dash minus, there is a bracket here, 1 minus f of k dash w k dash k f of k. Okay, so this particular term is taking you from k dash to k, and that's why there is a positive sign here. And this term is taking you out of the k state, and that's why this is reducing the distribution. Okay, because we are looking at the distribution at the point k in momentum space, at the real space point r, and at time t. All right, so this was the basic formalism. And I had also shown you some examples for how to understand, for example, electron phonon scattering in this formalism. Then if you want to look at electron defect scattering through this and so on. Okay, so one can include all kinds of different quantum mechanical scattering processes, and we will look at some more examples of such things. So was there any doubt last time? We had looked at the electrical transport and derived a formula that I'm going to write in the next slide for the electrical conductivity. Okay, so if there are no doubts, let's move on to this expression for the electrical conductivity. And that expression, so basically what we had done was, if we want to look at electrical transport, And what we are talking about is basically DC electrical transport. So there is a DC electric field. Okay, so there is a electric field E. This implies that the external force on the electrons will be minus E times the electric field. So the electric field basically couples to the charge, right? And what you will get is a minus E times electric field, and that's what will enter the semi-classical equation, which is this: d h cross k by dt is minus E times electric field. Okay, so this will give us the dk by dt term. And in the DC case, if we want to look at the steady state, so there are many different caveats here. You should notice this. There is a DC word that has entered, because of which the electric field is independent of time. Then it's purely electric field, so that is why it couples purely to the charge. Then there is a steady state condition. So because of the steady state condition, we can assume that the del F by del T is zero. Okay. And if there are no gradients, say for example concentration or temperature and so on, then the gradient with respect to this the space will be zero. Okay, so the only term that will remain then is the electric field term, and for that we can write the left hand side of the Boltzmann equation in this way: minus E by H cross E by gradient k of f is equal to, in the relaxation time approximation, this reduces to f of k minus f zero of k by tau of k. Okay, so here again another input has gone in, which is relaxation time approximation. You need not restrict yourself to the relaxation time approximation. Okay, if you know, for example, the quantum mechanical probabilities of transition from k to k dash, that means if you know wkk dash, okay, if wkk are known, then the full expression for the I collision can be used. That's important to understand. And the relaxation time approximation will be used only if you want to get some, you know, phenomenological idea of what would happen under certain perturbations. All right, so then the full expression for I collision may be used. Okay, so given this, we can then find out what happens to the f of k. So remember, the goal of the Boltzmann transport formalism, is to find the distribution function in out of equilibrium conditions. That's the goal, right? So since the distribution function under equilibrium condition is known, that's a Fermi Dirac distribution function. Okay, and what this Boltzmann transport formalism allows you to do is that by including various kinds of scatterings, by including various kinds of external forces, by including various kinds of gradients, you can find out what is the new distribution function. Okay, and you will see later that we can use the same formalism for looking at optical transport as well, right? So if there is an electromagnetic wave that is shining on a certain material, so which means that there is a time dependent electric and magnetic field on the system, even then you can use the Boltzmann transport formalism. Okay, so it's a very powerful formalism. Even though it is semi-classical, it's actually extremely useful and gives us sensible results in quite a few cases. Okay, in actually most of the cases, right? And you have to use full quantum mechanical effects in a few cases, and we might discuss that at some point. Okay, so this is the basic goal of the Boltzmann transport formalism, and you can see that this equation allows you to do that. How is that? Remember, f of k is the new distribution function, right? F zero is the Fermi Dirac distribution function. So, and this f here is also the new distribution function in the presence of the electric field, which means that I can write this equation. I can take this entire thing on the left hand side, and I can write f of k is equal to f zero of k minus e tau k by h cross electric field dot gradient of f. Okay, so this is the equation that determines the new distribution function. So you must look at the parallel with other fields. For example, in quantum mechanics, the ultimate goal is that given a Hamiltonian, you want to find out the wave function, right? And the wave function can be a function of, in general, space and time, right? So if you look at classical mechanics, the most general goal is to find out the position and momentum as a function of time for every particle in the system, okay? So similarly here in the Boltzmann transport formalism, the ultimate aim is to extract the distribution function under gradients, under external fields, and including all possible scattering processes. Okay, so this equation gives us or allows us to obtain the new distribution function, which is f. Okay, and it tells us that the new f is basically the Fermi-Dirac distribution function plus a correction. Okay, but unfortunately, this correction is itself dependent on the new f. Okay, so because the new f is on the left hand side and the new f is on the right hand side, this can be considered or interpreted as a self-consistent equation. Okay, which means you start with a guess for the f on the right hand side, and then you get the new f on the left hand side. Then the new f that you get, you substitute it back on the right hand side, okay, and get another newer f, right? So if you do this iteratively, you can get a sort of a series in the f, okay, and that will allow you to get a self-consistent solution. But you can also think of this as a differential equation, because there is a gradient here, so you can think of this as a differential equation and solve this in the usual methods, through the usual methods of solving differential equations. Only problem is that this gradient of k can be a partial derivative. So in general, you will have a partial linear differential equation. Okay, so now the thing is, we considered the linear response theory. In the linear response theory, we want to know only the deviations of the distribution function to linear order in electric field. Okay, there can be under strong electric fields, there can be non-linear deviations also. But if you are restricting yourself to linear response, which means that the electric field or the energy change due to the electric field is much smaller compared to the usual characteristic energy scales of the system, then you can use the linear response theory. And under that theory, you can replace the right hand side f by the f0. Okay, and that gives you the full solution to the problem. So this is f0 of k minus e tau k electric field dot gradient k f0 by h cross. Okay, so this becomes the full solution to the problem. But under what conditions? We took DC electric field, okay? We took steady state, which means del f by del t was zero. We took no gradients, concentration or temperature. Then we considered the relaxation time approximation, okay? And after the relaxation time approximation, we took the linear response. So with all these conditions, we were able to find a new distribution function, okay? And in this distribution function, you can see that the relaxation time here has been taken to be a function of k, okay? Which means that for different k values in the Fermi C, the relaxation times could be different, which means that near the electrons near the Fermi level will be relaxing to their equilibrium state at a different time scale than the electrons which are deep within the Fermi C, okay? So that kind of a differential relaxation time can be taken into account within this relaxation time approximation. But how will you, in general, find the tau of k? How can we find the k dependence of the relaxation time itself, right? So for that, again, you need a new model, okay? You need to include certain quantum mechanical processes, and you need to say, okay, the relaxation of a certain state can be due to either inelastic processes or elastic processes. If it's an elastic process, then what is the time scale for a certain collision to happen? Okay, if it is inelastic process, for example, electron phonon, then again, what is the time scale? And not just the time scale, what is the momentum dependence of that time scale? So to do that, again, you have to evaluate the quantum mechanical probabilities and look at the scattering processes in detail. Okay. So any doubts so far?
Can you please explain what this linear response is doing here?
Yeah, sure. So basically what we want to do is that, let me write this once again. Okay. So in linear response theory, basically the idea is that the response of a system, for example, the response could be current when you apply an electric field, is proportional to the perturbation that you've applied. Okay. So in this case, the perturbation is the electric field, right? In general, what could happen is, and this is basically the statement of the Ohm's law. Okay. So in general, for many systems, you know that Ohm's law is not valid. Right? You can have a nonlinear dependence of the current on the electric field. Not only that, you can have derivatives or the integrals, for example, in inductors, capacitors, and in memristors, you can have a nonlinear dependence of the current on the electric field. Okay. So, but for most part, if you want to just derive the Ohm's law and look at the linear response of the system, which means that you want to restrict yourself only to very small electric fields, then you can replace the right-hand side of the Boltzmann transport equation by the Fermi-Dirac distribution function, which is in equilibrium. That's the idea. And formally, you can see this in the following way. F has been written as F0 plus some delta F, okay? But this delta F is just the gradient, or is proportional to the gradient of the new F, okay? So what we are doing here is that we can take this as a self-consistent equation. But then if you take this as a self-consistent equation and go even to a second order, then you can see that the electric field will appear as a square term. Okay, so let me show you that. So suppose I take this equation F0 plus or minus E tau electric field dot gradient K F0. Okay, this is the first order solution. Okay, now I take this solution and substitute it back in the right hand side of the Boltzmann transport equation. So what will I get? I will get F is equal to F0 minus E tau electric field by H cross dot gradient of this whole thing. Okay, F0 minus E tau electric field dot gradient K F0 by H cross. And you can see that this term is still linear in electric field, but this term is EE. Okay?
Yeah.
So that's why you can see that now you are getting a nonlinear term, right? And if you go on like this, you will keep generating higher and higher orders in the electric field. But then if the electric field is very small, or the change in the energy of the system due to the electric field is very small, then you can ignore the higher order terms. Okay, so that's basically the idea, right? But in general, linear response is expressed in this way, that the response of a system is proportional to the perturbation. Okay, and you will see later on that if we discuss something called Onsager's relations, then through the Onsager's relations, you can actually write down the response of a system being linear in, let's say, the electric field, magnetic field, concentration gradient, thermal gradient, and so on. Okay, you can even include spin transport, for example. Okay, so Onsager's relations are probably the most general form of the linear response theory. Okay, and these relations also allow you to, in fact, these relations have led to the discovery of many new phenomena. Okay, I'll discuss that later. Right, but is linear response theory now clear?
Yes, it's quite clear now.
Okay, good.
Sir, if I want to find the distribution function but without applying the linear response, then what will be my initial guess of F?
F0, that's the Fermi Dirac. So I'm saying that F is given by F0 minus some constant, right, times the electric field into gradient of F. This is the equation. Okay, you can think of this equation as a differential equation. For example, suppose I say that the f depends only on one dimension. Okay, let's say there is only kx in the problem and there is nothing else. Okay, then what I can do is I can write this as f is equal to f0 minus alpha ex del f by del kx. Okay, and this f is also a function of kx, x comma t. So f is a function of kx, x and t. It's a 1D problem. Okay, now you can see that this problem is like a first order linear differential equation. Okay, and this is an ordinary differential equation because this is only df by dkx, and this can be solved exactly. Okay, so you can solve this to all orders, for example, right? However, in general, if this is a partial differential equation, then what you can do is you can say that f to first order is f0, okay, or zeroth order if you want to be more precise. Then to zeroth order, it's just f0, and then you get a first order approximation for f, which is f0 minus alpha e dot grad k f0. Okay, so this is the linear response. If you want to go to quadratic response, you take this, okay, you take f1 and you write this equation e dot gradient k f1. Okay, and what you will get on the left hand side is f2. It's a second level approximation. So you can keep doing this, and at the nth level, you can write this as alpha e dot gradient k f n minus 1. Okay, so this is like a hierarchy of equations that you can readily implement on a, for example, computer. It would be very difficult to do this analytically. Okay, however, if you do have methods to solve a partial differential equation, which is linear analytically, then you can try to solve this original equation completely analytically. Okay, but in general, that's very difficult. So I hope that's clear.
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. So, so from this, we can get the first approximation for the new distribution function, and the new distribution function will be given by just f0 minus a correction, which is linear in the electric field. Okay. So given this, what we can do is that we can write down an expression for the current. Okay. And we can find out the current versus electric field relation, and that was given by Jn is this integral dk v of k times distribution of k, and this is the first Brillouin zone. Okay, by the way, all of this is given very nicely in the Ibach and Luth book. Okay, so please go through it. There are several details in that which are very interesting, and they obviously cover more than what I am talking about here. So please go through that book. So this is basically the particle current density. Okay, because when we consider electrical transport, then we have to consider particle current density. Okay, when you consider heat transport, you will see that there will be two different terms. Okay, so for heat transport, you need not have particle current density. Okay, even for spin transport, so if you want to consider, for example, spin transport, which is important in many devices these days. Okay, so I don't know how many of you know, but recently the Nobel Prize was given for an effect called the giant magnetoresistance. And in giant magnetoresistance devices, which are used in most of the high-tech devices these days, okay, in magnetoresistive memory, for example, MRAM, and in magnetic sensors, for example, and many other devices, okay, in hard drives. So GMR is extensively used. There you have to incorporate spin transport, okay, and spin transport can be independent of charge transport, in the sense that the particles are localized, okay, they may not be moving at all, but the spin could be moving. Okay, there could be spin transport because, remember, the spin, there could be, for example, spin waves, okay, where the direction of the spin could be moving as a function of space. right? So you can have a spin current density without having a particle current density also, okay? Which means that a system could be an electrical insulator, but could be a spin conductor, okay? That's entirely possible, right? And a system could be, for example, an electrical insulator, but an excellent heat transporter, okay? And you might know examples of those, right? Anyone knows a good example of a system which is an electrical insulator but an excellent heat conductor?
Mica.
Not mica.
Okay.
In fact, the example that I'm talking about is a better heat conductor than even diamond, than even copper. Sorry, I said the answer. It's diamond, okay? So diamond is actually one of the best insulators, electrical insulators, but its thermal conductivity is extremely high. Okay, so thermal conductivity, for considering full thermal conductivity, you need not have a charge transport. Okay, you need not have electrons alone which are carrying the heat. You can have phonons also which carry the heat. And remember, heat transport can occur through conduction and convection. And in conduction, there is no movement of particles, but in convection, there is movement of particles. Okay, and we will see that all of this actually relates to Seebeck effect, Peltier effect, and later on, I will show you that it relates to the Hall effect, the night shift, and so many other condensed matter phenomena that are extremely important in many fundamental physics phenomena as well as in technological applications. Okay, so for considering electrical transport, we can consider purely the particle current density, and for considering the particle current density, I can look at the distribution function, multiply that to the velocity for that particular momentum state, integrate that over all the momentum states in the first Brillouin zone. Okay, so that will give me the total current. And now you can see that this F here, if I substitute this expression into this, right, then you can see there will be one term which will be from F0 and the other term will be from the electric field. Okay, so this will give me some term. So let me write this as proportional so that I can do this quickly. V of k, F0 of k, and minus alpha electric field dot, and then here there will be a dk, V of k, gradient k, F0, right? And this term, we had argued that this term is going to be zero. And you can see that formally also, because if I write this V of k, let's say in Vx, okay? So let's say I'm looking at the x direction, then this would be just the Vx of k. So if I want to find Vx, you can see that F0, which is the Fermi-Dirac distribution function, will be just e to the power beta, Ek minus mu plus 1. But Ek is, for free electrons at least, h cross squared kx squared plus ky squared plus ky squared kz squared by 2m. And this is nothing but 1 by 2m px squared plus py squared plus pz squared, right? So, and px is mvx. So the Fermi-Dirac distribution function is even in the moment, in velocity, whereas you have an odd velocity term sitting here, which is why this entire thing goes to zero. Okay, so if you do this over the entire Brillouin zone. So on the other hand, this term here, you can see that there is a Vx here, but there is a gradient of the F0, and that will bring out another Vx. Okay, so this will become a term which is even in the velocity, okay? And F0 is already even in the velocity. So this term will give you non-zero, okay? This is not zero. And so then you can see that the current is basically proportional to the electric field. And what you are getting here is a conductivity tensor, right? So we had derived an expression for this, and the conductivity was given by, so this is again an expression that I can write by looking at the expression derived in this book. Vx squared of k, tau of k, del F0 by del E. Okay, and this you can convert it to a density of states integral by taking this integral dk by 8 pi cube and converting that to the density of states, and you will get integral dE d of E, okay, Vx squared of E tau of E del F0 by del E. And we know that this derivative of the Fermi function is non-zero only close to the Fermi level, which means that this entire integral now becomes important, or the integrand becomes important only close to the Fermi level. And to a very good approximation, you can write this as d of EF. The del F0 by del E is actually minus of delta, minus of the delta function. So that gets rid of this minus sign. Okay, E squared times this times Vx squared of EF, and then tau of EF, and that's it. Okay, so so this is how you can you can write down an expression for the conductivity, and this is very different from the Drude model conductivity. Okay, because in the Drude model you assume that all the electrons in the system take part in conduction, whereas this is telling you that only the electrons near the Fermi level actually participate in conduction. Okay, so this is what we had done until last time, and now what we will do is we will take this further and consider, for example, specific processes. For example, if you want to consider a metal, okay, and in a metal, in the relaxation time approximation, okay, I want to look at defect scattering and phonon scattering. So how does one do that? Without going to the full Boltzmann transport formalism, where it becomes a much more difficult equation, because remember, in the if I want to include the collision term in its full glory, then I have, then it becomes a very nonlinear, a highly nonlinear integral differential equation. Okay, and in the relaxation time approximation, the equation is still linear, right? So that is one big advantage if you want to solve the equation analytically. Okay, so in the relaxation time approximation, if I want to consider electron phonon and electron defect scattering, how do I do that? Okay. So to do that, what one can do is one can write down two different relaxation times, one coming from the scattering due to phonons and one coming from the scattering due to defects. Okay. So that is something that is entirely possible. And if you do that, then there is a certain rule of thumb which tells you that the total relaxation time is basically the inverse of these two. So in some sense, what we are saying is that these are parallel channels of scattering. Okay, these are not serial channels, in the sense that it's not that an electron will get first scattered by a phonon and then scattered and then get scattered by defect and so on. So these are, you know, these two channels can coexist simultaneously, that the system of electrons can get scattered by electron phonon, by phonons as well as by defects simultaneously. Okay, so in that sense, you can have a relaxation time which includes both of these processes in a parallel sort of a way, in a parallel resistor sort of a way, and that gives you this kind of a empirical rule. Okay, so this is basically just an empirical rule. Okay, and one should not take this, if you want to do something fully rigorously, then one should not take this seriously. Okay, but if somebody wants to get just a, you know, quick idea of what the conductivity will look like if you want to include electron phonon scattering and electron defect scattering, then one can include this total relaxation time in this particular way. Okay, so this tau phonon here is the average time between scattering from phonons. Okay, so and similarly tau defect is the average time between scattering from defects. Okay, so if I want to look at this, then there are detailed theories about this, but if I look at non-magnetic defects, okay, non-magnetic and quenched defects. So what do I mean by this? So let's say there are certain defects which you have introduced in a certain system. For example, you could have doped silicon with boron or with nitrogen or with phosphorus and so on. So then if the dopant does not move as a function of temperature, that is, it remains where it was, and the concentration doesn't change, then we call it quenched disorder. OK, okay, because they are all sitting in random positions, and the system has quenched disorder. But if you start annealing the system, which means that you start heating the system at a constant temperature, which is higher than the room temperature and so on, then you could have these defects which are moving, okay? Because you could have created, for example, a concentration profile because of which you have a dopant profile, okay? And higher temperatures can actually disturb that dopant profile and can give you scattering which is now spatially dependent. Okay, so the formalism that we are doing now will be invalid there, because the scattering will now be temperature dependent as well as it will be space dependent. Okay, because the density of the dopants will be different in different spatial locations. Okay, so for quenched disorder and for non-magnetic disorder, by non-magnetic we mean that the impurities that we have introduced into the system do not have local moments. For example, if you consider iron atoms in copper host, okay, these would be magnetic impurities. These are not non-magnetic impurities. But on the other hand, you could introduce, for example, gold impurities, okay, gold inside copper, and this would be non-magnetic, okay. Or you can have other kinds of impurities which do not have an intrinsic local moment, and that will be non-magnetic. And for magnetic impurities, there are slightly different kinds of things that you have to take into account, because there could be spin-spin scattering. Okay, so because the conduction electrons in the host have a spin and the magnetic impurities have their own intrinsic spin, there could be a spin-spin scattering. Okay. And spin-spin scattering has a very different kind of a temperature dependence. In fact, the person who solved the full problem, including spin-spin scattering, is Kenneth Wilson, and he got a Nobel Prize for providing a new method which helped us to understand the spin-spin scattering problem in its full detail. Okay. So, but let's not consider spin-spin scattering. This is just a potential scatterer, which means it's a non-magnetic scatterer. And for non-magnetic scatterers, which are also quenched, the tau defect is basically independent of temperature. Okay, because these are just sitting in fixed locations. The dopants are sitting in fixed locations. They are not moving. And their scattering would be considered independent of temperature and only dependent on the concentration of the impurities. On the concentration. Okay, whereas phonons are not the same. Okay, phonons will be strongly temperature dependent. The phonon scattering or the relaxation time due to phonon scattering will be strongly temperature dependent. Why would that be? Where is the temperature dependence coming from?
With increase in temperature, we can have more phonon modes.
That's correct. So you're talking about the distribution function of phonons, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So like in the case of dopants, there's not going to be a change in the dopant concentration or in the dopant profile as a function of temperature, right? Because we are considering quenched disorder. So there the temperature dependence was not important at all. But in the case of phonons, as you said, the distribution function is going to play a very important role. But is it the distribution function purely of phonons, or can the electron distribution function also play a role there?
Sir, can you please repeat it again?
So you said rightly that the number of phonons could change as a function of temperature, right? And because of that, the scattering due to phonons can be strongly temperature dependent. But could there be a situation where the electron density could also play a very important role? The electron distribution function could also play a very important role?
See, it also play an important role, but I think it will require more heat than required for phonons.
That's correct. So what you're trying to say is that at normal temperatures, since the Fermi energy is much larger compared to KT, that's not going to have a huge effect, correct?
Yes. Absolutely.
However, what I'm trying to ask you is what whatever you said is absolutely true for normal metals. Okay. But can you have a situation where the distribution function of the electrons or the electron density could be strongly temperature dependent? Do you know of any system where the electron density is strongly temperature dependent? In fact, you know such systems. Everyone knows such systems.
Graphene.
We all deal with them. Sorry?
2D system?
2D systems. Which 2D system are you thinking of? Are you thinking of an electron gas like a MOSFET?
Yes, MOS2, 2D MOS2 is also.
That one, like graphene or MOS2 or those kind of systems?
Yeah.
No, the electron density there is pretty much fixed. So what we are talking about here is the free electron density, right? The conduction electron density.
Okay.
So can you come up with something else, some other system which is very common? Actually, it's there all around us.
Sir, in semiconductors.
Absolutely. Semiconductors, the electron density is very strongly temperature dependent, right? And when we are talking about electron density, it's the conduction electron density, right? Because it's a exponentially changing quantity. Okay. So in that case, you can have a strong temperature dependence coming from the electron density or the electron distribution function also. Okay. Is this point clear? So, okay, so what we can now do is to try to find out what could be the temperature dependence of the tau phonon, okay, of the electron phonon scattering. And for high temperatures, so I'll come to that, for high temperatures, which means let's say the temperature is much greater than the Debye temperature, okay, we can think that the tau phonon is basically proportional to the temperature. Okay, and what is the logic for this? So basically, we can see that suppose there is a certain mean displacement, okay, or mean vibrational amplitude of the individual atoms. Okay, so that would be given by this U squared of Q. So if you remember, every mode, every normal mode of the vibration of the crystal has an associated displacement vector. Okay, so that's the U squared of Q, that's the U of Q, and the average displacement, the mean squared displacement would be given by average of U squared of Q. Okay, and from the harmonic oscillator problem the equipartition theorem, we know that this particular quantity has to be proportional to KBT. Okay, in fact, every single direction will give you half KBT, right? So this is basically proportional to KT, and the phonon relaxation time at high temperatures, because the equipartition theorem is valid only at very high temperatures where the classical limit is applicable, the tau phonon should be proportional to the temperature. Okay, so this is one clue, right? But what would happen at very low temperatures? Okay, and at very low temperatures, one has to take into account the full Bose-Einstein distribution function and look at the electron phonon scattering, and it turns out that there is a certain expression called the Bloch-Grunesen expression, okay, Bloch-Grunesen form, and that tells you that the resistivity due to electron phonon scattering is given by A T by theta to the power 5 integral 0 to theta by T x to the power 5 dx by e to the power x minus 1 into 1 minus e to the power minus x. Okay, so we'll not go into the derivation of this, but what you can see from here is that if the temperature is much smaller compared to theta, which is let's say the Debye scale, then the upper limit of this integral becomes infinity, and the proportionality, the resistivity becomes proportional to T to the power 5. Okay, so you can see that the tau is basically proportional to tau to the T to the power 5. So what you get from here is that if I want to write down the let's say the full conductivity or the resistivity, for example, then the resistivity will be given by rho zero or rho defect plus a t squared plus a t to the power 5. Okay, and this is true for temperatures which are much smaller compared to the Debye scale. But if you go to very high temperatures, then you can add, sorry, I should write here a b. And for very high temperatures, you will have a linear term. Okay, so at temperatures which are extremely small compared to the Debye scale, the t squared term will dominate. Okay, and this comes from electron scattering, right? So you can see that in the relaxation time approximation itself, one can get a decent idea of what the temperature dependences are of metals, right? For semiconductors, as I said, you have to include other terms like yeah.
Okay. Can you explain this equation once again?
Yeah, sure. So what I'm trying to say here is that the see, remember, the sigma is n squared tau by m, right? But the rho is ulta of this. Okay, so you see from this relation that the 1 over tau gets added up, right? So basically the resistivities from different scattering processes can be added up. Okay, and what we are saying here is that if you look at the resistivity here, then the resistivity will be due to the defect scattering, due to electron scattering, and due to electron phonon scattering. Okay, that's basically the idea. And the electron phonon scattering will contribute t to the power 5 at extremely low temperatures. But at higher temperatures, higher compared to the Debye scale, you will get a linear term. And that linear term will actually dominate, because the at squared is only dominant for very low temperatures. Okay, and this a is also quite small. So essentially at high temperatures, t much greater than theta, the resistivity usually has a linear form. Okay, rho defect plus some kind of a linear form. So that's basically the very high temperature form. And at low temperatures, you can have many different contributions coming from phonon scattering and coming from electron scattering, and a temperature independent term which comes from defect scattering. Is this clear now?
Yes, sir.
So we can add resistivities basically from this kind of a rule. Okay. And this particular rule has a certain name.
Sir, if we increase the temperature, will the resistivity increase? Will there be any highest value of resistivity, or it will increase continuously?
Yeah. Actually, that's it's one of the I should say very, very, very difficult questions that has been considered over and over and over again in condensed matter physics. So it turns out that the resistivity actually saturates at very high temperatures, okay, for many, many systems. And in fact, that's considered to be an open problem by many experts in the field, okay, that why does the resistivity actually saturate at extremely high temperatures? And one of the things that becomes important there is that if you look at the mean free path of the system, okay, the mean free path cannot be smaller than, for example, the lattice parameter, of the order of the lattice parameter. Okay. So if the mean free path cannot be smaller than that, then that gives you an automatic limit to the kind of scattering length. Okay. And that scattering length can be, you know, converted to a scattering time using the Fermi velocity. Okay. So basically that gives you an upper limit on the resistivity, because remember, the if I write the scattering length as Vf times tau, that's correct, yeah. So the scattering length has a minimum value, which means that the tau has a minimum value, okay? And if the tau has a minimum value, then the rho will have a maximum value, okay? So this sort of explains the upper limit of the resistivity, okay? And it has a certain name. I don't remember the name now, but this maximum in the resistivity has a certain name. But it turns out that in many systems, even that limit is actually violated, Okay, so the minimum scattering length becomes much smaller than even the lattice parameter. Okay, and how does one explain that, right? So it turns out to be a very difficult problem. Okay, and the entire problem is in interpreting the resistivity through the Drude formalism. One should not even interpret that. Okay, and it turns out that you can have systems where this kind of a maximum resistivity is violated and electron-electron interactions become extremely important, then spin-spin scattering becomes very important and so on. Okay, so it's actually an unsolved question, right? That in some systems, why do you see a saturation? And in some other systems, that saturation limit is actually violated. Okay, and I'll probably forward you. So this was Shomita, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so I'll forward you an article where this kind of upper limit on the resistivity is considered. And, you know, some answers have been given, but it's also explained that this is actually an open problem. Okay?
Okay, sir.
In fact, there is also a concept called the Mott minimum conductivity and so on. So there are, like the maximum resistivity, there is a minimum conductivity. Okay. So, and that is again due to the same philosophy that the scattering length cannot be any smaller than the lattice parameter. So Mott first gave this idea that if you just go on increasing the defect concentration in a system, then you will reach a point where the conductivity can only be a minimum, and then it should suddenly drop to zero. Okay, beyond a certain limit, the metal should suddenly become an insulator. Okay, because the conductivity cannot go below that minimum value. Okay, but then it was found that many systems went smoothly from a conductor to an insulator. Okay, and that's where Anderson gave his contribution of something called Anderson localization, which completely bypassed this entire scattering formalism and brought in a new phenomenon called coherent backscattering. Okay, and in that coherent backscattering, the resistivity would actually smoothly go to infinity, or the conductivity will smoothly go to zero, and the metal would transform to an insulator. Okay, and there was no minimum conductivity. So the minimum conductivity turned out to be zero. There was no finite minimum conductivity. Anyway, all of that is, there are stories connected with all those phenomena. But here we are looking at very simple level defect scattering, quench disorder, and phonon scattering purely in a semi-classical formalism. Okay. If you want to consider coherent backscattering, you have to include quantum mechanical effects, which are also coherent, okay, not just elastic, but also coherent. So the phase information becomes very important there. All right. Then the other thing is that if you want to look at, as I said, magnetic impurities, then you get again new phenomena, because magnetic impurities give you a scattering which looks something like this. Okay. So when an electron scatters from a state k dash to k, okay, you can also have a change in the spin, right, coming from an interaction of the impurity spin with the spin of the conduction electrons. Okay, and this can have a certain coefficient here, the J, which is basically the coupling of the impurity orbitals to the conduction band orbitals. Okay, and what this does is that it introduces a tau which looks like log t. Okay, instead of it being linear or quadratic or cubic and so on, it introduces minus log t. Okay, and what will minus log t do? So suppose I have a minus log t and I have a t squared plus b t to the power 5. Okay, if I have a resistivity which looks like this, then you can see that as you decrease temperature, these terms will decrease. Okay, but as t tends to zero, log t will go to minus infinity, which means minus of log t will go to infinity. Okay, so as t decreases, this term will rise, but these two terms will decrease. Okay, so it will give rise to a very strange phenomenon, because the resistivity, instead of actually decreasing, will start increasing as you go to lower and lower temperatures. Okay, and at very low temperatures, it turns out to saturate. So basically what I'm trying to say is that because of magnetic impurities, the scattering time could be very different from the scattering that you can experience by non-magnetic scattering due to defects or due to phonons or due to other electrons. Okay, and this particular phenomenon, this is rho of t versus t. Okay, this is called the Kondo effect, where there is a scattering of the normal conduction electrons by magnetic impurities. Okay, so imagine copper and imagine iron, which have intrinsic local moments, and the electrons are getting scattered off by these impurities, and this spin-spin scattering can have a very weird temperature dependence. Okay, and that introduces a kind of a minimum in the resistivity, and the explanation of this actually took around 30 to 35 years, and in fact this is still a very, very important effect, although not technologically, but in fundamental physics this is an extremely important effect. Okay, so and again this particular effect is completely out of scope of this course. Okay,
sir, I have a question here.
Yeah, go on.
Whenever we are having scattering with electrons or say phonons, mm-hmm. Then we are having some t to the power n kind of resistivity.
Yes,
but whenever there is some magnetic impurity, mm-hmm. then the resistivity form is strange.
Correct.
So why is it happening?
Okay, so that's exactly what I said, that trying to explain that would be completely out of scope of this course. Okay, so it turns out that the spin-spin scattering needs a non-perturbative formalism, okay, called renormalization group. So to understand this, so okay, let me go to a little bit of the history. Okay, so this phenomenon, this minimum in the resistivity was observed in the 1930s. Okay, but then the explanation of this was given by Jun Kondo through a perturbative formalism. So what he did was he said, okay, the total Hamiltonian of the system is the Hamiltonian of the conduction band plus the spin-spin scattering, where the one spin is a big spin coming from the impurity local moment, and the small spin is basically a combination of the conduction electrons scattering from state k dash to state k. So then what could happen is that what he showed was that if you look at the relaxation time, see, remember when I told you about the Bloch-Grunesen form for phonons, I didn't tell you how the derivation for that comes about, right? I didn't tell you, for example, that the rho phonon goes as t to the power 5, okay? And I didn't even tell you how the rho electron goes as t squared, right? So in a similar way, if I look at electron with magnetic impurity, then that Jun Kondo showed that this goes as minus log t. Okay, and for doing this, what he did was basically he considered Feynman diagrams corresponding to the spin-spin scattering and showed in the third order, okay, what he showed was that in the third order diagram, you get a minus log t contribution. Okay, and in fact, the surprising thing was that if you go to higher order in the perturbation theory, and here the perturbation is done with respect to this coupling J. Okay, so you are trying to write a Taylor's expansion for J, J squared, J cube, and so on. Okay, so it turned out that people took the calculation forward, people, you know, after Kondo, and when they did the higher order calculations, they found something strange. They found log T whole squared, log T whole cube, and so on. Okay, now remember, a log T divergence is weaker than a log T whole squared divergence. Okay, because log t itself goes to infinity, log t whole squared goes to infinity squared. Okay, so in fact, what people found was that if you try to do a perturbation theory in J, then it's a divergent series. It's not even a convergent series. Which means that the Kondo effect, if you want to try to take that into account, you cannot do a perturbation theory in J. Okay, you have to do a completely non-perturbative theory, and that led to the development of a method called the renormalization group method. Okay, and this renormalization group method was discovered by many people, but the credit to this credit for discovering this goes to Kenneth Wilson. Okay, and he got the Nobel Prize for this. But anyway, I mean, I have not told you how this arises, and this arises. So Maybe at some point, if we do an advanced solid state physics course, I might talk about that. Okay, but for now,
okay, sir.
It's out of scope of this.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, I have a question.
Huh? Go ahead.
Sir, when we put a magnetic impurity in copper, say, then the magnetic atoms are sitting in randomly. Then here the magnetic impurity basically the spin spin interact. But when the iron atoms are sitting large distance apart, will there be any strong magnetic effect? That means will there be any strong exchange effect between so that we can call it purely magnetic? That
very good question.
I think in this case there will be itinerant exchange.
Again, that's a very good point, but let me come to that. Okay, so what you are saying is that let's say there are these magnetic impurities which are sitting in random positions, but the intermagnetic impurity distance, L impurity, is let's say much greater than the lattice parameter. Okay, so that's essentially the situation that you want to consider, right, Shobhit?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
So in this case, as Shomita said, there could be something called an itinerant exchange, which goes by the name of RKKY. Okay. So RKKY exchange, which is basically not a direct exchange or a super exchange between the magnetic atoms, but it is mediated by the conduction electrons of the host. Okay, so the conduction electron interacts with this spin, okay, and then carries that information coherently in the sense of a spin coherence time, coherently to the other magnetic atom and interacts with that. So through this, there could be an indirect spin-spin interaction, SI dot SJ, okay, which is dependent obviously on the distance between the two atoms which are placed in the system. Okay, but this JIJ turns out to have a very different form. It has a form which looks like this. It's actually oscillatory. Okay, so you can have a ferromagnetic interaction or an antiferromagnetic interaction depending on the distance, right? But in most cases, it turns out that the situation that I talked about for the Kondo effect, the concentration of magnetic impurities that you need is extremely small. Okay, in fact, the model that is most used for understanding the Kondo effect is called the single impurity Anderson model, which means that you forget that there are any other impurities in the system totally. Okay, you think of the system as having only one single impurity and then try to understand how does the density of states of that particular impurity change because of the presence of conduction electrons which are trying to screen that spin. Okay, so in most cases for understanding the Kondo effect, the magnetic exchange is not important. Okay, that answers one part of your question. The other part is, in case the concentration increases, then you can have an itinerant exchange or an exchange which is called RKKY exchange, which is mediated by the itinerant electrons or the conduction electrons in the system. Okay, so there is no direct exchange, there is no super exchange, for example. Okay, does that answer your question?
Yes. Okay, sir. If we consider not iron atom, if we consider suppose manganese atom or something, then
manganese also has a spin.
Yeah, that's why I wanted just a single spin at the outermost shell. That is important.
That is important. Yeah, you need to have unpaired electrons. Yeah, it needs to have an intrinsic local moment.
Yes, sir, I understand.
So magnetic impurities can have many there are many novel phenomena associated with magnetic impurities, and there is something called heavy fermions, there are something called magnetic monopoles, there are all kinds of very interesting effects, but just look them up sometime. Okay, but Kondo effect is one of them, which is one of the paradigms of understanding correlated electron systems. That if you want to understand electron-electron interactions, then Kondo effect is like a paradigm. Okay, in the same sense that, for example, if you want to understand non-interacting electrons, then band theory is a paradigm. Okay, so in the same sense, if you want to understand interaction between electrons, then Kondo effect is one of the standard paradigms. Okay, so anyway, let's move further and go into thermal transport. All right. So suppose I want to consider now thermoelectric effects. Okay. And you know the many different, there are at least two different thermoelectric effects that we know of, right? That if you apply a thermal gradient, right? Sorry, a thermal gradient, then that can lead to a voltage. And applying a voltage can lead to a thermal gradient, okay? So both of these effects can be taken into account in the Boltzmann transport formalism. And how does one do that? So if we now take the time dependence of the electric field to be zero, okay, so it's a DC electric field. And if we say that there is a thermal gradient, but that thermal gradient is also static, okay, which means that the time dependence in thermal gradient is zero. And the explicit time dependence is also zero. Okay, so this is a steady state condition. And in this steady state condition, I can write the distribution function in this way. It's going to be f0 of k. Okay, and then as usual, there would be a e by h cross tau e dot gradient k of f. Okay, so this was the usual electric field term. But now, because the gradient of the temperature is non-zero, you could have a minus tau v dot gradient of f. Okay, so and this gradient you can see is going to come about because in the Fermi function or in the distribution function there is temperature which is sitting, and the temperature is now dependent on space, on the spatial coordinate, right? So now instead of having just the electric field term, we also have the temperature term, the temperature gradient term, right? So I can write this again in linear response as follows: f naught of k plus e by h cross tau e dot gradient k of f minus tau del f0 by del t, okay, v dot gradient with respect to r of temperature. Okay, so now you can see that we can now describe thermoelectric effects, because remember we found the current or the electrical current through the f of k, right? And now when we write the current expression again, then not only will there be an electric field, but also there will be a gradient in temperature. Okay, so in other words, we found out earlier that J was proportional to electric field. But now what we will find, okay, this was earlier. So now what we will find is that the J will be proportional to something multiplying electric field and something multiplying the gradient in temperature, right? So if there is a gradient in temperature, that can give rise to a current. Okay, if there is a gradient in electric field, that can give rise to a current. But under open circuit conditions, when the current is zero, then these two can give rise to each other. Okay, so do you see, from this one equation a new phenomenon can be discovered, right? So if you had taken the Boltzmann equation, Boltzmann transport equation seriously, and then looked at all possible terms, one can actually go about discovering new phenomenon. Okay, so again, try to understand what I'm saying. The current is proportional to the electric field plus something proportional to the gradient in temperature. Okay, and in this equation, if I substitute E equal to zero, then J becomes proportional to the gradient of temperature. So what is this telling you? This is telling you that applying a temperature gradient leads to a current, right? So that is called one of the, either the Seebeck or the Peltier, I always forget. Does anybody know for sure what is this effect? That when you apply a thermal gradient, you get a current? Do you know?
Seebeck effect, sir.
This is Seebeck, right? Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So this is Seebeck. And the other thing is, if I apply a temperature gradient, right? If I apply an electric field, that can produce a temperature gradient. Okay. So that you can see by looking at these two relations. So let's say I produce an open circuit condition and I apply a voltage bias. that can actually give rise to a temperature gradient. Okay, so that's the Peltier effect. And the Peltier effect can be actually used for cooling, okay, because you're applying an electric field. So you're sending the electrons to one side and that will carry energy and one of the sides can actually get cooled down. Okay, so the inverse effect is the Peltier effect. And you can see all of that is actually contained in this equation, right? So, and both of these quantities, yeah.
Sir, in the transport equation, del F0 del T, will there be any del F0 del T?
I'm sorry. This is not small T, this is actually capital T. This is temperature. Sorry.
Okay. Oh, sorry, sir. I understood. Sir, yeah. the tau in the electric field and the tau in the temperature gradient, are they same or different? Mm.
Very good question. They are not the same. Okay. So,
yes, sir. That is why.
Yeah. So, here maybe we can write this as tau 1 and tau 2. And usually tau 1 is not equal to tau 2. Okay. And it turns out that thermal transport and electrical transport are thermal gradient and a electrical field or a potential gradient can have very different relaxation times. Okay, so in other words, thermal transport and electrical transport may not have the same relaxation times. And there is an argument for that, but let me not go into that right now. Okay, but the relaxation times need not be the same for both of these transports. Okay. And the other thing you can see is that the distribution function has a positive sign here, but a negative sign here. Okay. So what this is saying is that the increase in the distribution function will happen if there is a negative gradient in the temperature. Okay. Which means that, let's say there is a system and there is a T1 here and there's a T2 here. If the T1 is much greater than T2, right, then the gradient is this way. Right, which means that the higher energy electrons will actually move out. Okay, so if you consider purely the thermal gradient, then what will happen is there are much higher energy electrons here than here. Okay, and so the diffusion will be, or the drift because of the thermal gradient, will be in this direction. Okay, but you want to consider, for example, the f of k at a certain position, then you can see that the f of k is actually going to decrease at this point and increase at this point. Okay, so that's why there is a minus sign here and there is a plus sign here, because the increase in the f of k is caused by the direction of in the direction of the electric field and the gradient of the distribution function. Okay, so sorry, I was a little bit incoherent there, but basically the electric field gradient, okay, or the potential gradient will cause an increase in the distribution function, whereas a thermal gradient will cause a decrease in the distribution function. Okay, so that's basically the idea. All right, so let's go ahead with this and then calculate what these coefficients are. Okay, and so what we can do is we can write now the J as L11 times E plus L12 times minus gradient of the temperature. Okay, and these are actually called the L's are called the Onsager coefficients, and there's a whole theory about it. Okay, so I'm not going into that completely. The L21 electric field plus L22 minus gradient of temperature. So this is the this is electrical transport and this is thermal transport. Okay, this is not thermoelectric transport, by the way. This is thermal transport, which means transport of heat, right? And this is electrical transport, which means transport of charge, right? So the transport of charge is controlled by electric field and also by the thermal gradient. But the thermal transport can also be controlled by electric field and the thermal gradient. Okay, so there are coefficients for these also. So now I want to ask a question. Suppose I have a magnetic field, okay, that is also not zero. Where do I include the effect of the magnetic field in the Boltzmann transport formulas? Any idea?
in the electric field part.
How do I do that? Go ahead, you're right. So in the same place where I included the electric field, I should include the magnetic field also. But how do I do that?
We can go from Maxwell equations.
Okay. Which equation? There are four of them.
Yeah.
Yeah. So go ahead. Which one should I use?
We can use a third or fourth Maxwell equation, which says one says curl of E equal to minus del V del T. I think it will be better.
So let's say I want to consider purely DC fields. Okay. So there is a DC electric field, there is a DC magnetic field. Okay. Time independent. Now, how do I do it? Anyone? How do I include
velocity cross magnetic field?
I'm sorry?
Velocity cross magnetic field that is effective to
correct, correct. So you are saying that when we had considered the external force, we had said it is QE, but now we can include the QV cross B also.
Yes, sir.
Correct? Yeah. So yes. that's correct. So that's one way to do it. And in fact, that's a very important way to do it. So using this, you can, for example, include things like the Hall effect also. Okay, so you can explain the things like Hall effect. Now, let me ask you one more thing. Okay, suppose I want to include spin effects. So remember, the magnetic field also couples to the spin, right? So how do I include spin? So how do I include spin into the Boltzmann transport formalism? Because remember, in all of the formalism that we have considered, the F was a function, the distribution function was a function of R, K, and T. Where is the spin of the electrons gone? How do I consider that? How do I bring it back into this formalism?
Sir, in K part, we can have another quantum number S.
In the K part, what do you mean by in the K part?
That the band structure calculation, the K part is from band structure calculation, and in band structure calculation, we neglected the spin effect. Now, if we include spin effect, the only part will be changed, the K part. And
So what you said is in the band structure calculation, we ignored the spin part. That's not completely true. Okay. You can do a spin dependent calculation also, but let's consider a system where the band structure is independent of the spin. For example, you could consider a paramagnetic system. Okay. In a paramagnetic system where the symmetry of the spin rotation has not been spontaneously broken, there the spin does not enter the band structure, which means both the upspin band and the downspin band have exactly the same structure. Okay, so in that case, the K will not be associated with sigma. Okay, but the magnetic field can still couple to the spin. Okay, and the magnetic field is going to break time reversal invariance. Okay, which means it's going to couple to the spin and break the spin rotation invariance. Okay, spin rotation symmetry, I mean. Okay, so in that sense, what can happen is that the distribution of electrons will be different for the upspin and the downspin. So by upspin and downspin, what I mean is that we are looking at the entire system as a, I mean, the conduction electrons have spin half, and because they have spin half, we can work in the eigenbasis of the sigma z, which is the poly, the z sigma z poly matrix, which has a spin up and a spin down. Okay, two spinners. 1001 as the eigenstates. So that's why we can consider, for example, F up and F down. Okay, and here what can happen is that when we consider specifically an F up, for example, there could be scatterings which relate to W, for example, a spin flip. Okay, So these kind of spin flip transitions will give rise to either an increase in the F up or a decrease in the F up. Okay. So this is a scattering which takes you from the up state to the down state. And this is a scattering process which leads you from the down state to the up state. Okay. So this will give you an increase in the F up and this will give you a decrease in the F up. Similarly, you can have an F down also. Okay. So the distribution function itself can become spin dependent. And this kind of a spin transport is also useful when you want to consider, say, things like spintronics. Okay, so if you're studying spintronics, then and you want to use the Boltzmann transport formalism, then you have to make the distribution function function of the spin also. Okay. Sorry. So yeah. So at this point, I mean, there are some relations related to the Onsager coefficients also. Tomorrow I'll again come back to this and show you what are the different phenomena that are still waiting to be discovered, okay, using these relations. But for now I want to close this, and if there are any more questions I can take them.
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, W up down and W down up, they are different, right, in magnitude?
They could be different. Depending on whether